All right. Happy Tuesday, everybody. It's Tanya time. Welcome to Vegas Sports Girl, and that tune always gets me up and moving. I can't believe this is the end of July already, and August is just around the corner. And sitting to my right, my co-host, Ron Futrell, is in the house looking mighty busy on your iPhone.
I'm texting my brother and my nephew down in L.A., and they're telling me how the stadium down in Southern California, the Rams, I don't even want to call it Charger Stadium. Let's just call it the Rams Stadium. 70% done.
70%.
That stadium done, and they are rolling right along to be able to get that done on time. The one here in Vegas, 50% done is what I've heard.
It's a competition.
Well, both are supposed to be ready by the start of next season, so that's all that matters. Get it done by the start of next season, everybody.
And you would know, because you're a huge Rams fan. We've got more Rams news coming up. We'll be talking about the big scrimmage game next week. I'm so excited.
Yes.
Anyway, coming up later on the show, we have a special guest on, former running back of the Pittsburgh Steelers and Chicago Bears, Merril Hoge, will join us. We're going to catch up with him and see what he's doing these days, maybe get some insight on what he thinks the Pittsburgh Steelers will do this fall. And also recently, Hoge wrote a book called Brainwashed, The Bad Science Behind CTE and the Plot to Destroy Football. Very controversial topic. So we're going to hear more about that book and see what Merrill's up to. Exciting, right, Ron?
No, I am looking forward to it. Also, I want to hear what his son's doing. Bo's playing quarterback. He's a freshman quarterback at BYU.
BYU.
So would be curious.
That's great. You have to ask about that, because
yes,
BYU is your neck of the woods.
Yes.
Right?
Well, I'm from Southern California, but yes, I lived in Utah as well. Yes.
Very nice. Well, we have some headlines to talk about. This past weekend was the WNBA All-Star Game at the Mandalay Bay Event Center. It was a huge success. I know Friday there was a skills challenge and a three-point contest. Kobe Bryant, Chris Paul, and Megan Rapinoe were in the house. NBA big breaking news today. CJ McCollum signs a three-year extension with the Trail Blazers for $100 million. That money just gets me every time. $100 million. NHL hockey news. I don't know about you, but I am missing our Vegas Golden Knights and those games. I was just saying yesterday, I miss going to T-Mobile. But we do have some hockey news. Chris Kunitz retires. Lightning.
Oh, don't just wash over that.
Let's talk about that.
One of the best players for years with the Pittsburgh Penguins, and they're gonna miss him this year. And there was a lot of talk on when he was going to, what was going to happen there. But yes, him retiring from Pittsburgh is a big deal.
Big news. Now, and if I'm understanding
correctly. Not unexpected,
correctly,
but a big deal. Yes.
I'm understanding he's actually joining the Blackhawks organization.
Oh, he may, yeah, too, as a coach or something like that.
As a coach.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and of course, locally, and I don't know if you're going to get into this, but I'll jump into it. The Golden Goose, Nikita Gusev, traded and sent to New Jersey for a couple of future draft picks, a second round and a third round draft pick. And that boiled down. The Golden Knights fans wanted to see him and who this player is. I mean, this is a guy who is probably the best player in the KHL. That's the Soviet Hockey League, the premier minor league in hockey. And he was a four-time All-Star, leading scorer last year. He was the Knights' property. They paid him the minimum last year at $700,000 a year. But he wanted a much bigger contract to be able to stay. He's a restricted free agent, but he wanted a much bigger contract to stay here with the Knights and a longer contract. They weren't willing to pay him what amounted to $4.8 million, I believe, with the New Jersey Devils. So he's off to the Devils, and we'll see what those future draft picks. Knights are still loaded with draft picks. I mean, that's one of the things they've got plenty of, are draft picks. So they've got a couple of more for the Golden Goose. I would have liked to have seen what he could have done here in Vegas, but that ain't going to happen.
It's not going to happen.
So go ahead, off to New Jersey.
Say lovey.
If I think it's... I wish now the Knights would have kept Eric Holland. There's the other part of this. That's another center.
I agree with you on that.
And I thought that even before the Nikita Gusev thing, but still, I think Eric Hall is a guy that we're going to miss this year on the Knights.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe it's personal. You know, I like him. I thought he was a very good player. Obviously, hurt his knee about a third of the way through last season, and that had him out for the season. But his first year was a phenomenal year. He was having a good second year with the Knights. So that's unfortunate. So, but the lines are starting to shape up. You can put the lines together.
Absolutely.
On the Knights to see what they're going to be like on offense next year.
I'm so excited for opening game against the Sharks. So excited. I can't wait for that game.
You don't want to know where we're at with that one?
It's such a rival.
Let me see. It is. Well, it's become. Yes, it has become that. Knight's first game is 63 days, 7 hours, and 54 minutes away. There's an app for that.
You've got a time clock.
There's an app for that. There's an app for that.
I'm ready for the Knights to get back.
Well, and camp's going to open a month from now. So camp will be here. And then first exhibition game is September 15th.
Very fun. Very fun. The Lightning, they trade Ryan Callahan to the Senators for goaltender Mike Condon and a few draft picks here and there. Let's talk NFL. We are in full swing with training camp, and our friend from Dallas Cowboys, Zeke Elliott, will not report to training camp, has not reported. Where is he? Cabo.
Oh,
it's just amazing.
Be,
I mean, you would think this guy would show up and watch his P's and Q's after what he's been through as of late.
He has been through some rather off the field incidents that has affected him, I think. I don't know if it's affected him. I mean, it should. You would think it would. But anyway, and then Jerry Jones says, we don't need a running back. We can win the Super Bowl without one. Well, okay, and I assume that's in jest because, what you do if you're a defensive lineman, you pin your ears back and you go after Dak Prescott and you turn him into Marshmallow Man back there and smack him to the ground a few times. And then now you got to go the season without a quarterback. So good luck.
That's a pretty bold statement, that Jerry Jones. So basically, I'm taking that as the holdout's probably going to continue for a few more days.
Well, and it's negotiating. They're negotiating publicly right now
in
the contract dispute, and so that's Jerry Jones saying, "Fine, stay in Cabo, stay wherever you want. Go, we'll do whatever we." And Ezekiel Elliott, very good running back. Cowboys need him. Go Buckeyes, Ohio State guy.
Right.
But they do need him if they're going to do what they need to do on offense. If Dak Prescott, the quarterback, is going to have time to be able to throw and do what he needs to do in the pocket. You're going to have a good running back to make defenses honest, and I don't know where they go after Zeke.
Speaking of Dak is also waiting for hopefully a new contract to be drawn up, but he showed up for camp looking mighty fine out there, so we'll see what the Cowboys do this year. Other news in the NFL, Kansas City Chief Tyreek Hill was carted off the field at training camp yesterday. Reports show that he had a bruised quad. Not good news for the Chiefs. And Miami Dolphins fire, this is big news, their O-line coach, Pat Flaherty. I guess that's a big, big position. I mean, if you're going to fire a coach, now's the time to do it. I give him credit for that.
So, right at the start of camp, and if they've got somebody else in mind.
They brought in Dave DeGuglielmo from the Indianapolis Colts to take his position. But, you know, in my opinion, if you're going to make a change, do it now. And this is real critical because if you don't have a good O-line, your quarterback's never going to get the job done. So I guess Miami said, we need to do it now.
Yes.
Cut him very quickly.
See my Dak Prescott statement from earlier this segment about defensive linemen pinning their ears back when you don't have a running game or you don't have an offensive line that's efficient. And the two go together, by the way. If you have a good running attack and a good offensive line, what you're able to do is keep defenses honest. That's what I love about football is really the team sport aspect of it, the symmetry that is required for everything to work together for a team. When you're talking about the offense to be able to work effectively together, to have that balance. I used to think as a kid, as a Rams fan growing up, I remember reading the stat page one time, and it showed that Dick Bass, that's how old I am, former Rams running back with Roman Gabriel when he was quarterback, but Dick Bass was averaging 3.4 yards a carry.
Wow, that's nothing.
But my point was, I did the math. I'm a kid learning math, and I go 3.4, 3.4, 3.4. You get that every, so just hand the ball to Dick. In my mind, I'm thinking, just hand the ball to Dick Bass.
By third down, you're going to make a first down.
You're back in the first down. Even on fourth down, if it's a little bit short, he's going to get 3.4 yards the next time. Not understanding at that time what the balance of football that is required to be able to play the game properly. Of course, anybody now, you become an adult, you understand, when I played football in high school, you understand you got to have that balance. And you can't just run the ball every play, and that average will not hold up if you continue to do that. But my point is just that it has to have the balance. great teams on offense.
Absolutely.
Look at the Rams this past year with Todd Gurley, you know, and what he was able to do offensively, and he's the question mark this season for them. And Sean McVay, the head coach, put together a very balanced offense. When Cooper Kupp, interior receiver, went down with an injury, the team struggled. They lost that balance all of a sudden. They weren't as solid as they were on offense, and certainly they struggled in the Super Bowl because mm-hmm. of that.
It's always the mix. It's the mix of players. And Sean McVay, in my opinion, one of the best play callers in the league. It's going to be great to see what they do with the Rams this year. That's a hard division. That Western division is tough. And now Shanahan's there. We've hopefully got more of a healthy team with
you
the
49ers.
I don't know. Seattle looks pretty good, too.
There you go.
So and we'll see.
If Arizona wakes up, watch out.
If they wake up. It's fun watching Derek Carr and the Raiders work in Napa. They will appear in Hard Knocks next week. I cannot wait to see that. I was watching Mike Mayock and John Gruden together. Really good pair. Very similar philosophy. You know, and they said, when we come to training camp, we want to keep the distractions out. But they were able to accommodate NFL films, so I think that should be a good series.
Yes.
I want to see behind
the scenes. We want to keep the distractions out, but here comes HBO, NFL films.
And speaking of Raiders, next week I will be in Napa for a few days of their training camp, and Thursday they're taking on your Rams in a scrimmage game.
In a scrimmage, and then they're going to just practice up there together with each other for 2 days. And then have their exhibition game in Alameda Stadium mm-hmm. on October 10th, 5 o'clock Pacific time start on that one, Rams-Raiders in the first exhibition game of the season. So we'll see. I mean, it's a practice football. So, I mean, and the starters will play maybe two possessions.
It's exciting to talk Raiders. I can't believe I'm even saying that, to be honest. I never looked at the Raiders and said I'm a huge fan, but they're coming to Vegas. I'm a fan.
Well, they are. This time next year, they're here.
Yeah,
so
it's exciting.
And at the end of the season, assuming the Raiders don't make the playoffs, just sorry, Raiders fans, which is a safe assumption. You know,
Do you think so?
Oh, they're not a team that I see making the playoffs this year. Now, it could be. They've had one winning season since they went to the Super Bowl in 2003, and that was the one that they made when they went 12-4 and made the playoffs. They won a lot of games at last seconds, and they lost after the first round of the playoffs when Derek Carr got injured, so that was an injury issue. But yeah, they've had one. Now, you know, optimism with Gruden, absolutely. Optimism with some new things that they can do. But Derek Carr's got to step it up this year. That's bottom line. They've got issues. They've got to look at quarterback issues, and they've got good young running back. We'll see what he can do. It's out of Alabama, so we'll see.
Didn't Antonio show up in a hot air balloon, too?
He did. Well, he did. I'm glad he showed
impressive.
Up. It was a day late, but he showed up, and a hot air balloon came down and looked good, and he'll be fine. 84 will do well on this team, and it will give the Raiders a deep threat that they did not have last year. Well, because he traded him away to Dallas, or got rid of him, just gave him to Dallas, basically. So, yeah.
Well, we have more football coming up, but in soccer news, I'm gonna switch gears.
U.S.
soccer news. A lot of news lately about the salaries and the women's soccer players. This was really interesting. Okay. Soccer president Carlos Cordero came out and said, after analyzing payouts over an 8-year time span, long story short, sum it up, the women were paid more with salaries than the men. So the women were paid over 8 years, $34.1 million by the Federation, and men were paid $26.4 million. I thought that was pretty impressive.
By the U.S. Federation.
Yeah.
Just by the U.S., okay.
Interesting, right?
There you go.
Well, we have more NFL news. Coming up after the break, we will have alumni running back Merril Hoge will join us. We'll talk more about his book that just came out recently. I want to thank our sponsors, Finley Volvo and Las Vegas Motor Speedway, for your support of Vegas Sports Girl. Check us out on social media, Facebook, social, Instagram, Twitter, you name it, we're there. Like us, share us, and check out our website as well, vegassportsgirl.com. You can actually place bets. We will have more coming up in just a few minutes.
How can I help my daughter with her reading?
I went a little early. But
searching
that's all right.
For help with docs and reading.
Okay.
How can I help my daughter?
All right. One of these, I think, is out.
Yeah.
So I don't know which one it is.
It out. No.
The sound. Are you going to be able to get it?
Yeah, I'll be able to get it.
Okay, do you want to call? So this segment, call Merril now.
Okay.
And then how much time before we come back? About 2 minutes? Or?
Yeah, about 2.5 minutes.
Okay.
Yes.
So I'll just do a little intro, and then we'll go into him and his book. Thank you.
Wait, I was trying to show you how Sarah feels every day. Frustrating, isn't it? Redirecting to understood.org.
Fed one in five kids.
What's that?
That was a good block.
Yeah. What might it feel like? Explore understood.org. Andrew Luck out with a calf strain?
Yep.
What's going on?
Well, there's a lot of players that are going to be sitting out too. Julio Jones for a few preseason.
Yeah, if it's a ruse, okay. If it's just to rest him up.
It's just preseason.
Yeah.
I look so funny with these little glasses.
I know, those glasses are great.
I feel so like old. Thank you. I've been taking dance classes lately.
And? How's it going?
Kicking some butt.
So how many days are you going to be up there? You're going to be up there 2 days?
I'm going to be just be up there one.
Yeah, I'm trying to reach Merril.
Okay. So one night you're staying up there?
Hello, I'm trying to reach Merril. Yeah, hi, this is Chris with the Vegas Sports Girl. How you doing, man? Good, good. We are in a break. We'll be back in about a minute and 20 seconds or so. All right, I'll place you on hold, and we'll pod you up. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem.
So this book, let's talk. Brainwashed
on? Yes.
I'm giving you that serious.
Serious.
And then the next block, we'll go to break, and then I have him to about 4:40.
Okay. So you'll keep him through the break then?
Yeah, keep him through the break. Let me see.
Excited to be a part of pop culture. He packed for the big city. The odds of finding someone to invest in his vision? 1 in 4.5 million. The odds of him achieving his dream in the fashion industry? 1 in 23 million. The odds of having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 68. I am Tommy Hilfiger, and my family.
Tommy Hilfiger. This is, you know, CTE and concussions is such a serious issue.
Yeah. I've heard he doesn't buy the correlation between football and... Yeah, it's really interesting. Yeah,
so that's why it's controversial.
I don't know about that.
Well, but I like an alternative. I don't know. Alternative opinions, okay.
Yeah.
I love somebody that doesn't see that at least sees things a little bit differently and goes, questions.
I think the Three Stooges were the innovators of concussion.
Yep.
Oh,
yeah.
All right. Welcome to Vegas Sports Girl. And Ron, you were saying something?
Love the Elvis. Okay. They're a little sad. It is 50 years ago today.
Uh-huh.
50 years ago today, Elvis began his second run at the Las Vegas Hilton, which later became, well, the International, which became the Hilton, and is now the Westgate. Today. 50 years ago today. What is today? Tuesday? No, it's Wednesday. Tomorrow. Thank you. It's tomorrow. 50 years ago tomorrow, Elvis began, after a long drought of not performing live, he came back, did live here in Las Vegas at the International. So anyway, just a little
tidbit
little
for
tidbit
you.
With
a
Elvis
lot of history. Well, as we talked to NFL earlier, training camps are in full swing and fall sports are just around the corner, which may mean parents are concerned with their own kids playing sports because of potential concussions and head-to-head contact. In January 2019, the NFL came out and reported that player concussions were down 29% from the previous year. Obviously, this is a serious topic, one we see often in pro sports and outside of pro sports. Joining us today, former running back of the Pittsburgh Steelers and Bears, Merril Hoge is on the phone. How are you, Merril?
I'm great. How you guys doing?
Hey, buddy. Thanks for joining us here on Vegas Sports Girl.
It's my pleasure.
So in 1994, your career was cut short due to multiple concussions, which are traumatic brain injuries caused by a blow to the head. And shortly after, you wanted to learn, understand, and research this entire condition. You recently wrote a book called Brainwashed, The Bad Science Behind CTE and the Plot to Destroy Football. Tell us more about CTE, and what was your motive to write this book?
Well, let me clean up a couple things first. My career ended because of improper care. of a concussion, and that's really important. And it's important that people that are listening to you, parents listen to you. When you think where concussions come from, it's a very simple answer. Everywhere. It's not just sports. Okay. There is more. More head trauma comes from accidents, falling, wheeled sports, vehicles, than anything. Almost triple than that. That comes from the environment of sports. So concussions and head trauma can happen everywhere. It's not just sports. And we need to be very clear on that, because people think it is just sports. You know, parents are pulling kids out and they're like, well, I don't want to get a concussion. I don't want to get hurt. And I'm like, well, first of all, what is the percentages of incident rates with concussions? They are the least likelihood of injuries to happen. Now, that being said, it's the most vital organ in the body, so it should be treated as such. You know, we should take proper care of it. So trying to clean up a lot of the misconceptions is where what I ended up putting in the book. But what really sparked me to write the book was my quest to really just educate myself and inform myself about all of this narrative I've heard of CT. It just didn't make sense to me. I've lived every aspect of it. I've been coaching since 1991, coaching ages 8 to 28, youth football to pros. I know how much better and safer the game is now than when I played. But nonetheless, I didn't really understand what the science of CTE was, so I just went on a quest. I would talk to professor after professor after professor, independently, them not knowing I'm talking to other people, because I wanted to have clarity from everybody that I talked to, that they weren't influenced by somebody else or somebody else I've been talking to. And a couple things came in that journey. When I would ask a trained brain doctor, an MD, you know, people who have been studying science and are have a medical background in it, not somebody who wrote a paper. There's a value there, but however, they're not in the category that you need when you are trying to understand the science of it. They all would say the same thing to me. They're like, Merril, just slow down for a second. You know, and I'd say, listen, it's in sports, it's this. I'm like, they're like, it's a tau pattern that we have discovered, and it's in an observation state. We don't know what causes it, and we don't know what it causes. And I said, well, what do you mean by you don't know what causes it? I mean, the way I'm seeing it on TV and radio and everything else I see, it's football. And they're like, well, wait, then how do you explain the 100 cases in the medical journal that never played sports, never had a history of head trauma, never had a concussion, but yet they have the pattern? And I was like, no, what? I go, why don't we hear about that? And they're like, that's why we're in an observation state, for it to be beyond that, for a narrative to be created beyond that. And this is unanimous in the scientific world. And anybody that would want to contradict that, which you have a lot of that, you just have to ask them for clarity. Give me the scientific literature and verify what you're saying. What I'm going to share with you and what I'm going to talk to you about, I could send you all the scientific literature. I can back what I'm saying. And then I went one step further. I started to read the science papers. And actually, the first one I came across, Dr. Ann McKee out of Boston University had authored it, and it was the 99% paper. And what really kind of probably disturbed me more than anything is I read the paper itself, and I got to the conclusion of it. And when you read caution must be used in interpreting the high frequency of CTE in this sample and estimates of prevalence, the next word's important, cannot be concluded or implied from this sample. That's what the scientific literature said. Wow. So basically, based on the methodology and just how poor the science work was done in this paper, it puts in there, you can't use it. And quite honestly, from a Hippocratic oath from those doctors who signed it, you should never use it. Well, what does Ann McKee say when she gets in the public arena on it? When she gets quoted in the media about that science paper she just authored, she says, I got to believe after doing the paper that just says you cannot use this to conclude any prevalence or imply from the science paper she just wrote. She goes, I got to believe all football players have it. Now, I can't think of a more grotesque abuse of the Hippocratic Oath than for a doctor to do something that disgusting. Now, it wasn't just one incident. Then it really sent me on a journey. I started reading more of the scientific literature, and then I'd read their quotes. I'd watch her interviews. And she'd literally lie and contradict everything in the scientific literature. Well, that's when I decided a book needed to be written. Have I lived every aspect of this? Absolutely. But I didn't really understand the scientific literature, that the narrative that Boston University was driving it from. Once I read the contradictions and the absolute lies and the corruption, you can't do enough interviews to really put it all in perspective. You needed I need to write a book. I found Dr. Cummings, who was one of the very few, actually, and this is bothersome, actually, for just the general population. And in the scientific world, there's so much bullying and threatening going on that a lot of people don't want to stand up and say the truth for fear of their careers. And that's why Dr. Cummings, I give him so much credit, because he had stumbled across it too, quite honestly, on his own journey. And then our paths crossed. But he's a 3-board certified forensic professor out of Boston University, who he wasn't going to let his son play till he actually started reading the literature.
Sure.
Because he just kind of let the news drive him as well. And once he found out the truth too, he was like, and here's to his credit, he said something I've always really thought it was important. From a parent perspective, he said, if I'm going to rob my son of doing something that I love and that I find great value in, I'm going to make sure I know why I'm doing that. You know, and obviously he's more qualified than the average person out there, so he could read through it fairly quickly and understand the facts. And you know, he's right there in Boston University, so he can find out the stuff. I mean, everybody can get the scientific literature, but just understanding and reading is not an easy task, and it's more arduous than people want to put effort into. So what I did in the book, quite honestly, is I did all of the scientific literature and used Dr. Cummings to really help explain it so people understand it, and we also gave them resources so they can validate it. Because I tell people, be skeptical of me. You know, anything I say, if you want to contradict it, I have a website called brainwashedbook.com that we put the scientific literature up. We want you to read it. We want you to go there. We want you to ask questions. We're not trying to hide anything. We're not selling anything. And we're trying to give people the real facts and information to help them with choices that they make for their families.
Interesting. And I know that what you really dove into this through your research, you actually cut a human brain up to study it. Tell us about that.
Many of them. I never thought I'd do that, trying to be honest with you. I mean, I've been this journey, but I actually felt like I had to do that to understand it from a, you know, just to actually see it being done and have the understanding of it. And I was blown away. I was blown away on a litany of things. And I'll give you the first one. Dr. Cummings takes me in, and there's a half a dozen brains sitting on a table. The first thing that struck me is he said, on that table, brains range from 36 years old to 101.
Wow.
Now, the first thing I thought about was I'd seen the kid from Washington State who committed suicide. Typical media blames CTE, which nobody's ever died from CTE. Nobody's committed suicide from CTE. Maybe the narrative, but not the actual pattern. It's never happened. They say I have a brain of an 80-year-old. And now, as soon as you hear brain of an 80-year-old, what is your visual impression of that? It's a person who's 80, you know, a shriveled up, older looking brain, right?
Sure.
That's exactly why I was like, well, wait a minute. You would clearly know the 101-year-old brain if that were the case versus the 36-year-old brain. They all look the same. I mean, it reminded me of mushrooms. I mean, they're all the same, but a little different. You know, but you can't tell, you know, one distinct mushroom over the other, age of it or whatever. Well, that's how those brains were. I mean, there were some different colors, but it wasn't so ambiguous from the other. Just the size was a little different. And I said, well, wait a minute. I go, how do you know how old they are? Okay, this is a 3-board certified forensic. Like, professor, how do you know? And he goes, by the birth certificate.
Wow.
I said, what?
Wow.
I go, what happened to the age? He goes, there's no such thing. He goes, there's some 80-year-old brains I have gotten looked into look better than a 21-year-old brain and vice versa. And he goes, it just really depends on the tau pattern. Now, that a person does accumulate in their brain. And keep in mind, we all do. And just because you have a tau pattern, here's what's hard. They use the word disease. Well, what does that register to you and I? That registers a problem, right?
Interesting.
That's not necessarily true. If you have a freckle on your arm, that's an abnormality of the skin. That is a disease. That doesn't mean you're going to get skin cancer.
Wow.
And I was like, well, wait a minute. I go, oh, my gosh. Then when he took it apart, we really removed the brain, and we looked at how he went about dissecting it, I go, what's covering the brain? He goes, it's called the dura. So when you think about how the brain is protected, first of all, it's not like Jell-O. It doesn't jiggle around. Can it move? Yes, but it's not like Jell-O. It's almost like firmer bread dough. Then it's wrapped in this dura that is secure, and then the plasticity around it, then skull structure. I mean, our brain is as protected an organ as any organ in our body.
Absolutely.
And so there's a whole bunch of deceptional things that I experienced that I was like, wow, that the media uses. And there is just, there's ignorance and then deliberate ignorance. And a majority of the media is just deliberately ignorant because they choose not to investigate and study and look at and validate what is being said. And it's not that hard. You just got to do some due diligence. But everybody who's ever interviewed me in this journey, I've asked them, have you read any of the scientific literature? Now, these are journalists that are spreading this information. All of them say no to that. I'm like, well, how do you validate anything? That's your responsibility. And it just then it doesn't shock me where our narrative is. I mean, nobody's validated Ann McKee. Ann McKee is about as a corrupt human being as I've ever seen, especially with what this is doing. This does harm to people. When you scare people and you have no validation, especially scientific, that she speaks on to support what she says.
Merril, this is Ron Futrell here. And what's the motivation of... I'll say the other side. Those who believe CTE, there is a connection between brain injury, CTE, and the game of football. Ultimately, what are they trying to do here? What's your thought?
Well, all you got to do is go look at the millions of dollars they get because they created a problem. It doesn't go very far from money. Shoot, if you dig into them far enough, they're already working on medication to help something they don't even know what it is.
Money from the NFL, from the NFL in particular, is one.
Money from the government.
Oh, okay.
They get the millions of dollars that they get funding from the government. Blow your mind. What they have done, do you dig in there far enough? There's more corruption there than you could possibly shake a stick at. And this is not the first time this has ever happened. I mean, to our government, to the general population. In the 80s, the government told America, they gave us a first dietary requirement in the history of our country. And what was it?
It was
stop
the food.
Fats. Get away from fats.
Yeah, and the food pyramid before that was was about the worst food you could have.
But first of all, just if you know anything about nutrition, fat is a requirement. There is a nutritional requirement for fat. How could anybody say, get away from fat? Now, there's saturated and unsaturated. There's good and bad fats, don't get me wrong. But you know what? Our organs and our internal organs, especially our brain, it's vital for brain health.
Right.
And our government tells us to get away from it. And what happened? Everybody went into simple carbs and sugar.
Yeah,
sugar
perfect.
Consumption
sugar
alone
and grain.
Destroys more people in this country than any one thing.
That's the ticket. More sugar, more grain, right?
No.
And that was our government. Scientific information. But that was scientific information that was also corrupt and misleading and poorly done.
No,
and
the other
complete done, and then government used that to present a guideline to the American people.
The only thing wrong with fat is it's called fat. It's got a bad PR rap because it's called fat. But your dietary stuff, absolutely, I'm with you 100%. And yeah, I don't know whether that was coordinated to help the wheat farmers in the Midwest or what it was.
Well, I can
or why
you,
it was.
I can send you an article that'll verify
but it was.
The scientists were paid off. The sugar industry paid off the scientists to manipulate the science and say it was fat. And see, here's the, what
well,
the,
then lobby the government, and you're there. There's the circle. Lobby the politicians,
right.
And you got to meet.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, you know, you just don't have to go very far when you see these type of things, and you say, what? If I get that all the time, well, what is there all, you know, why would they do that? When you look at the two things that really are the root of evil, money and ego. And they're so caught up in themselves, they believe they can't be touched. They think this narrative has gone at such a strength it can't be stopped, but eventually the truth will come out, and the evidence of the truth.
Hey, Merril.
And that is why, really, I wrote the book, because we put all that stuff in there, and really all the things that are going on in sports that parents should know about, that they should be excited that their kids are active, if they are active, and if they're not, they really should be active, especially in the environment that exists today.
Well, and there's also cognitive treatments and different plans for this, too, so that's good news for parents.
Well, yeah, I mean, listen, if your son or daughter, now listen, for sons or daughter or anybody get some type of head trauma, okay, post-concussive symptoms are not CTE, and it has nothing to do with tau pattern, but it does have a relationship to head trauma, and it needs to stand that pillar, but the media has just grouped it all together. So people can have a concussion, they can have post-concussion symptoms, they can have things that linger, and yes, you're right, Frank, there's terrific treatments for those type of brain issues. Dude, I'm looking at John Saunders. You may or may not remember him. He was
ESPN.
A Mount Rushmore at ESPN, absolutely.
Yeah.
John Saunders slipped in a studio, had dealt with head trauma, post-concussion symptoms for years. I mean, he was just, I mean, literally was driving him crazy. And he finally came to me, and I took him to UPM. I got him to UPMC in Pittsburgh, where they evaluated where he was most vulnerable, where the head trauma came from, where what part of the brain they need to work on. They gave him a cognitive plan, a nutritional plan, and a physical, a training rehab plan. In about 3 months, John Saunders had finally had his brain health back, the cognitive issues gone. I mean, I remember him calling me, driving over the Walt Whitman Bridge, because I said, yo, John, there's going to be a day it clears up for you, and you're going to be like, oh, my gosh. It's like, it's going to hit you, and you're like, oh, my gosh. And he was driving over the Walt Whitman Bridge, Philadelphia, New Jersey.
Hey,
he
Merril,
called me up about 3 months later to let me know that it cleared up, and he was so thankful for treatments and therapies that are available.
In your opinion, do you think the NFL is doing enough with their protocol?
They're the front runners. They are the best in all of sports at what they do, from their protocols, the treatments and therapies, from not just that, from equipment to the fields they play on, to how they train and prepare themselves. Absolutely, absolutely. But that's not what I'm concerned about. That's not what I'm worried about. 1,800 of those guys plus play in the National Football League. You know where 99% of our athletes are? 8 to 18. That's what I care about. I care about 8 to 18.
Okay, I got to ask you this, Merril, while we got you. And on the line with us is Merril Hoge. He's got a book out called Brainwashed, former NFL player. The Bad Science Behind CTE and the Plot to Destroy Football is the title of the book, and that's who you've been listening to. You got a son going to BYU as a freshman quarterback this year, Bo. What do you think? They got Utah right off the bat, okay?
BYU football going to be bad? Bo, believe it or not, Bo is he'll be going into his senior year, but he graduated last year. And
even though
he has 2 years left, he's decided to work on his MBA, and he retired from football.
So he retired I saw a dated article. I thought he was, okay, so he's retired from football, and...
Yep, and he's moving on with his life's work.
Well, good for him. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, he got a great education. He had a fantastic academic experience at BYU. His football experience that was a different story, but...
Well, the program's struggling.
Changes in 4 years, and... you get hurt, and they don't care for that properly. You just, you know, can leave the sour taste. But listen, he's happy with. I'm glad, grateful for his education, and he's excited about, you know, his life's journey and his life's work.
Hey, Merril, you're coaching your call football. Can you tell us more about that?
Well, really, to put it in very simple terms, it's like live match. Fans call our plays and have a chance to make money calling, being an offensive coordinator. We just finished our second season, giving over almost $200,000 away. There was an opportunity for $1 million for the perfect game called, And but it, the personal side of it, it gives me a chance to coach pro players and develop pro players, guys that need some more reps. And we had a fantastic time doing it. Fans that, you know, were involved and engaged in the process, I know they had a blast. And it's a very unique experience when you you have to have the fans call your plays. But what I would do as one of the coordinators and head coaches is you put a bundle of plays up every down and distance. There's three options, just like Madden. Fans have 10 seconds to vote on a play. The majority of the votes, whatever play gets the majority of votes, is the play that comes into me. I send into our quarterback, and that's the play we run. So it was a fun league. We'll see where we go with it next year. But it's the type of technology that I can see the XFL using as part of their league. I can see the NFL using in on the Pro Bowl, spring games, you know, for colleges. And it actually works in other sports, too. It's not just football.
That's awesome. And I remember when I worked for the 49ers, we actually played the Pittsburgh Steelers in Spain at an American Bowl. That was a great time. Let me ask you your thoughts on the Steelers this year, and was it a good thing to extend Coach's contract, in your opinion?
Well, as soon as people heard it, they only gave him a year deal. And now he's got 2 years on his deal, so they gave him an extra year. So now he has three. So it's not just one. They just gave him another year. And what that does, if you look at Ben's contract, he has three more years. Mike Tomlin, three more years. You know, shoot, I don't know what that will be with Mike, but it's got to be around 18. You know, if he does all three of those. You know, and that's a long run, man. I mean, and you think of the Steelers, three coaches. If he continues that, you know, between Chuck, Bill, and I played for Chuck. I played for Bill. Gosh dang, we're looking at almost 50 years and three coaches,
right?
Or more. And some teams do that in 5 years. You know, when you think of their consistency and what they have done and the coaches they have found there, it's pretty pretty incredible. But I think it's smart because it matches up with Ben. And you know, 3 years, a lot of changes and a lot of things happen. So I think there's security there for 3 years, and that's a lot more than some coaches get from the very beginning, you know. So I think it's a good thing for the Steelers.
And I know you've got an event. You do a lot of things in the community. You do a ton of speaking engagements on both of your books. Also, your first book, Find a Way, was awesome. I encourage our listeners to buy your books. Where can you find your latest book if somebody wants to purchase it?
Well, it's anywhere in any bookstore, maybe on Amazon, but you can go to merrillhodge.com, and I have a site there to do it. I mean, go to Amazon. And I gave you brainwashedbook.com. I also have it there, and all the information to help people if they want to explore a little further and find out more things that we put on there with podcasts and stuff. So that's the way, would be the easiest way to go about purchasing it. You know, and listen, if you're, you know, if your kids are involved in any sport, not just football, you know, I mean, shoot, especially wheeled activities or anything, and you're fearful of something, the best thing I've ever found is to educate yourself on it. And
Absolutely.
If you really did buy the book and read it, I think you'd be empowered as a parent about what your kids are doing, how active they are. And if they did have an accident, if they do, say, slip in the shower and have a concussion, like my son did 4 days before his first bowl game, and happened to be the Las Vegas Bowl, by the way.
Wow.
But he now can't play. It isn't because he didn't have a concussion on a football field. He had a concussion, and he slipped in the shower.
In the shower. Yeah.
4 days before, and now he's ineligible to play. So it doesn't just happen in sports. But all the treatments and therapies that exist today that we can get our kids and you can get your brain health back is a real powerful thing. Let me give you a couple websites. This is for people that maybe struggle with mental health too, or post-concussion symptoms, and they're two different things. But there's rethinkconcussions.com. So rethink is altogether.com. Great information on treatments and therapies. And then mytransformations.com. Mytransformations.com. That is a website and information on this magnetic treatment and therapy. And it's FDA approved. You know, they've been using this for years. But it's getting people off medication and helping people that might be depressed, have anxiety, PTSDs. We're doing a lot of stuff with our veterans and in the VA hospitals. But there's so many good things out there that we can help people with concussion issues or mental health issues that are not medicated, I think is so important that people know and understand. There's more things that should be empowering people versus scaring people, and that's what's so troublesome with this unbelievable narrative that they have no scientific evidence to back, by the way, is we're scaring people, when really we should be empowering people because there's so many amazing things available.
Awesome. Merril, thank you so much for joining us. Really, really appreciate your time. Brainwashed, the bad science behind CTE and the plot to destroy football. Hoping we'll see you out here for a Raider game. Got to keep it in the AFC. But thank you again. Thanks again for joining us, Merril. Have a wonderful afternoon.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
All right.
Hi, Merril Hodge.
Good stuff. All right. We are going to roll out to break, and we will see you in just a few minutes.
Yeah, you just gotta let him go. I mean, he was on a roll, so.
So this will be short.
Yeah, it's fine. 50.
What time do we need to get out?
Well, your musical end at 54:50.
54:50.
I'll give you a countdown. It's like 5 is 50, 4 is 40, 3 is 30.
Yeah, I worked with him at ESPN.
Oh yeah.
We did. He was actually one of my mentors. So him and Chris Berman and Sal Pal. Love Sal Pal. Greg Cassell is going to come out. He's coming out here from NFL Films in a few weeks.
Oh, okay. What's next week? Do you have next week lined up yet?
I'm like really booked next week. As far as people that want to be on the show.
Oh.
I might have Rams. I have Shriners, the golf tournament's coming up. I think there's a few things I have to just kind of nail down. Probably two call-ins. San Francisco and the Rams.
Yeah, no problem.
Worked out really
well. Ari just told me I needed headphones. I'm like, oh, okay, cool, headphones.
George
he
Kittle and Cooper
Kupp.
Yes, George Kittle. Oh, I love George Kittle. He's so good.
Oh, okay, well, let me go
He's
get
He's so
your
fun
headphones.
To watch. And I heard, I just got a little pop-up that said D. Ford might have injured himself at practice. So I'm like, what's going on here? I like how he says that. Sounds so like chill, relaxed.
I know it is. It's
you know?
Great. You get those endorsements.
I like it. Welcome back to Vegas Sports Girl. That was a very interesting conversation we just had with former running back Merril Hodge on his book. Very interesting. We've got a couple tidbits of notes. I know we've got more NFL news. We were talking about Julio Jones and Andrew Luck.
I have some breaking hockey news.
Okay,
too,
you
at
do.
Some point I want to give you. You want to do it now? Or
Julio Jones, Andrew Luck will be sitting out a few preseason games. What do you got?
Yeah, Andrew Luck out. That is crazy. It's like a strained calf or something like that. So I hope it's just for both of these guys that it's just a break from training camp and not something more serious. Luck obviously has had his share of injuries as quarterback with the Colts. But the rookie faceoff, this upcoming NHL season, it was held last year here. The six West Coast teams, all of their youngsters, play three games against each other in 3 days. Do the math on that. That's three games a day. And the Knights are going to be playing. The Knights, obviously, were not breaking news that they were going to be playing in it, but it's in Anaheim this year.
Oh.
September 7th through the 10th. At the Great Park Ice Arena in Anaheim. The Knights start off on September 7th, taking on Colorado. So you've got basically the Kings and the Sharks. You've got the Ducks,
fun.
The Knights, Arizona, and Colorado. Those six teams all play. Like I said, they did the first one they ever did was last year. So it's a great training camp thing. Again, from the 7th to the 10th in Anaheim. The rookies, the youngsters, the guys fighting to make the squad, and there's going to be one, maybe two defensemen that might make this Golden Knights team to start the season. And A lot of people are looking at Cody Glass now that Nikita Gusev is gone from the Knights. A lot of people looking at the possibility of Cody Glass stepping up into a spot at center, maybe on the third or fourth line of this team. So, hey, there you go.
Sounds fun. I think, and our fans travel very well. They'll have a good turnout
in
L.A.
There will be fans already in Southern California that
yep.
are there just to go down for, but we'll travel down there, and I think that's a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, if my memory serves me well for those
we'll
dates.
We'll have to be down there. We'll have to go do that.
What do you think? Road trip.
Our Aviators begin a 7-game homestand tonight against NOLA.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Fun.
Yeah.
Aviators, the games last week were a lot of fun. I went out to a couple of them, thanks to Jim Gemma. It's just so relaxing out there. I love going out to that summer lit. I just love watching the Aviators. It really is relaxing.
They play tonight, so they're back. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that. And the weekend games, they've got four games starting Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, with the Oklahoma City, which is the L.A. Dodgers farm
sure.
team.
Yep.
They say L.A. Dodgers, folks. It's their only visit this year, and I think they will come every other year since they're in the other division. So this will be the only real chance this weekend to see the Dodgers AAA team. But boy, are they, as a Dodger fan, they're packed. This is a team that's got a lot of great players on it. And Austin Barnes, I think, was just sent down, so he'll be playing with this team. Will Smith sent up. So look forward to that. So a big series here for the Aviators beginning tonight, yes.
Very sad. The Dodgers got beat by Rockies. That was a tough loss, 9-1.
Oh,
that was the largest loss.
Yeah,
I don't know what happened there. You know, that was
it
happens, though.
Still have the best record in baseball. So.
And speaking of NOLA, did you happen to see or follow the Saints training camp? Did you see Drew Brees throwing passes out to Zion Williamson? That was a lot of fun.
Drew Brees, help me refresh my memory. I've not heard of him.
Yeah,
Drew Brees, he's a quarterback. He's still wearing number 9.
Does he have any stats or numbers?
No, I did not see to Zion Williamson, who is going to the New Orleans Pelicans and going to be starting there. He played here in the summer league. And, he'd make a pretty good wideout, or let's go tight end with him, probably. I'm going to go
sure.
for a big body at 6'9", 250, 60.
So fun to watch him.
He's a pretty big
you
dude.
Know.
So, yeah, I would say, yeah, and a lefty at that. So
It's going to be interesting to see what the Saints do this year. They've got one of the best offenses in the league. I anticipate they'll have a great season again, hopefully.
Well, they should have some motivation.
And
I mean, they're all off-season they complained about that call against the Rams, so we'll see if it motivates. So they play the Rams again this
did
year.
Did that
they
bother you at
they
all?
They
didn't
have the Rams. Well, calls happen in games. Was it horrible? Yes, it was a bad call, but there's a lot of bad calls that happen in the course of a football game. There were a couple of calls that I could point out in that game that went to the Saints' favor that were key calls and critical calls in that game, but yes, I get it. That was at the bad point, bad situation there for them. Oh, it cost them a trip to the Super Bowl. Well, okay, whatever. Okay, show up and let's see what happens. They got the Rams mm-hmm. again this year, and then another shot to let them meet in the NFC title game again. By the way, it'll be this time in the Coliseum because the Rams will have home field. That's just my prediction if it
nice.
Happens.
Very nice. And Le'Veon Bell apologizes to fantasy players and said, "I'm so sorry for such a bad year last year. This year is going to be much better. We'll see what he can do this year."
Okay, then. I'm wondering, number one, this is not a fantasy football show, but because it ain't that. But
why not? We can have fantasy.
But we can talk a little bit of it.
Right.
Yes, it's not a show. Oh, no, there's people that have shows, like full hour-long shows just on fantasy football. It would drive me nuts. That being said, I don't know, number one pick, do you go with Todd Gurley this year? Midway through the season and the last half of the season, I remember tweeting out a picture of Todd Gurley and said, here's everybody's number one pick for next year. But I don't know with the injury, with the knee stuff going on, whether that's going to be, whether he would be that. I don't know. We'll see.
We shall see. And Aces will play the Mystics on August 5th. That was the game that was moved after the earthquake. We want to thank all of our listeners for staying with us on Vegas Sports Girl. And as always, Ron, thank you for joining us. It's always a pleasure.
It's my pleasure.
It is. Again, check us out on VegasSportsGirl.com and social media. Again, thank you to our sponsors, Finley Volvo and Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Have a wonderful week, and we will see you next Tuesday.